Good morning. Welcome to Cedar Creek Bible Church. You are a rowdy crowd this morning. That's a good thing. There's a lot of life here today. Well, I welcome you to the service this morning. I'd like to invite you to take your bulletin out. On the back side, you'll find our scripture reading. I'll invite you to stand with me as we read this together from Isaiah 53:3-6. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hid their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. I'll invite you to open your hymnals, if you want sheet music, to 275, How Firm a Foundation. You can find that on the screen behind me as well. And I'll also invite you to stand with me as we sing together. That's hymn 275, How Firm a Foundation. Singing this morning. I'll invite you to turn over to an insert in your bulletin titled He Will Hold Me Fast. And of course, yes, you can find that on the screen as well. He Will Hold Me Fast. Pastor, I feel like we've sang this before. Have we not? Not as a congregation. Huh. It may be familiar to you as well as it is to me. So hopefully it is.
Thank you.
Amen. You did very well with that song. You may be seated.
You sing that like you believe it, that he will hold us fast. Let me just remind you of some things that are in your bulletin today. First of all, a service committee sign-up sheet. We certainly would encourage you to be busy about serving the Lord, and one way you can do that is by helping out with various committees. Take that, fill it out, get it back to Annie sometime between now and the 9th. She'll appreciate that. Also, if you want to stay up to date with what's going on in terms of prayer requests, the purple sheet, the half sheet in that folded in with the service committee sign-up sheet, is for you to sign up for the prayer cord. You can do that either with your email address or your phone number. We'll either contact you one way or the other, whatever you would prefer. Again, same thing with that. Give it to Annie. Stick it in her mail slot, whatever works for you in the next 3 weeks. Two constitution and policy proposals that we spoke about last Sunday, they were inserted in your mail slots last week. This week, they're available on the table if you didn't get them. One of them, they both look very similar if you look at the cover of them, but one of them deals with Article 4 in the Constitution. So those are the organizational information about the church. We brought this to the congregation for your review on January the 24th. We're bringing it to you now on May the 2nd in the evening for your approval. So, of course, Brian will ask, are there any comments? But the time to have made comments was back in January, right? Why are we doing it that way? Well, because we became convicted that our congregationalism was thin. Here's what I mean by that. We had been in the habit of bringing you documents like this and just bring it to a congregational meeting. You had a chance to review it. You can ask questions, make comments at the meeting, and then vote. What that implies is that your comments don't matter. We got convicted about that. So now you'll see the deacons bring stuff to you twice. Bring it once for input, to get input back from you, and bring it back to you again for a vote. So this is coming to you the second time on May the 2nd. In contrast to that, the four policies that begin to look alike, but again are different in terms of the wording, are ushering policy, communicable disease policy and guidelines, wedding policy, and policy for use of church property are coming to you for the first time on May the 2nd. We want your input, your comments, your questions on that document. So a couple of things going on at our regular congregational meeting on May the 2nd. Why is the congregational meeting not tonight? Because we got young preachers tonight. Yeah, typically it would be the last Sunday in April, but we bumped it back to the first Sunday in May because we are looking forward to four young men tonight who will be bringing God's word to us. Most of you this morning parked in the parking lot on the north side of the church building where you always park. And we've had these conversations. We had a brief conversation at a congregational meeting in January about replacing this parking lot. And so the deacons have finally gotten off their duff and have begun to work on this. So we have a proposal from Murray's Asphalt to replace, there's a slide for this, Aaron, to replace the south half of the north parking lot. So that image there, the church building is above, the parking lot's below. So this is going out from the church building about halfway, $80,000. It's amazing how expensive asphalt can be. So the deacons, last Sunday afternoon, approved it. And they also dumped $40,000 out of the general fund into the parking lot fund. Some of you have been giving to the parking lot fund already. Thank you for that. Now, here's our challenge. Would you please commit with me to sacrificially give to fill up the rest of that $80,000 so we can pay the bill when the parking lot gets done? Which could happen, Tyler says, any time. Is that right? Well, then we're going to have to get busy. Any question about that? Yes? So there was, when the deacons met, I'm looking for Nick. Nick Keck. Oh, he's out in the narthex. $2,500 last Sunday in the parking lot fund? Yeah. There was $2,500 in the fund we put another 40,000 over into it. That's 42.5. We need to, the bill, the proposal came down from 82 to 80, Tyler, is that right?
Correct.
So that means we only need $37,500. So if, I guess if you're just gonna put that in, let somebody, let Nick know so I'll quit asking for this. No, it was $2,500 when the deacons met last Sunday afternoon, and they dumped $40,000 over. So we're $37,500 short. Whew. I think that was all I wanted to talk to you about this morning. Sorry about that. Thanks for your patience. Let me take a moment and pray with you. We call you Father because we're your children and because Jesus taught us to pray this way. We call you God because you are our creator. We call you Lord because you're sovereign. If you hadn't graciously revealed truth about yourself in your word, if you hadn't told us about yourself in the Bible, we wouldn't know really anything about you, and we certainly wouldn't know how to address you. Father, we're forever failing to appreciate our Bibles. We don't know what your word says because we valued the latest newscast or the latest Amish romance novel more highly than we value your word. We love those things more than we love scripture. We fail to see the Bible's big picture because we have only read it in bits and pieces. Do what is necessary, Lord, to correct us in this, to change our habits, even if it's painful. Do what's necessary, Lord, to force our hands to pick up our Bibles with vigor. We come before you this morning, Lord, with gifts in our hands. We don't present these to you in some kind of an attempt to merit your grace, to get you to love us more. Nothing we've done could merit your grace. Nothing we do could take it away. We really have just one hope in life and death. We have been clothed in Christ's righteousness. You've loved us, Father, not because we were lovely. You've loved us just because you've loved us. We present these gifts out of love for you, responding to your love for us. We ask you, Lord, to use these funds. Use them here, use them both near and far for your glory. And may Jesus Christ be praised, in whose name we pray this morning. Amen.
The Bible Stands is our next hymn this morning. You'll find that on an insert in your bulletin. And if the Bible stands, then I suppose so should you, right? I know, I'm hilarious. The Bible Stands. Let's sing together. Something very important. Junior church kids, you can be dismissed now. Okay, now that we got that out of the way, stanza two. Finally, hymn number 270, Wonderful Words of Life. 270.
Thank you.
seated. Thank you.
Aaron, show me the next slide. Who is that? Curious George. Was he curious? He was curious about everything. It's funny, Pastor Holmes and I had a conversation about Curious George this week. He doesn't have any room in his worldview for Curious George. He says, I didn't suffer fools easily when I was a child. Is he talking about you, Garrett, or Wyatt? Thanks. It's enough of that. In our third section of 1 Peter chapter 1 this morning, we find Peter once again describing our salvation. Salvation which was made available to us by the finished work of Jesus Christ. Salvation that is ready to be fully revealed in the near future. Salvation that will result, we saw last week, in the praise and glory redounding to God. Here in verses 10, 11, and 12 of 1 Peter chapter 1, he tells his readers that both Old Testament prophets and angels were curious about this salvation. This hope that we have, this new birth's hope, is based not just on a future that is ready to be revealed, a future inheritance, based not merely on present blessings, but also on the written word of God. Our salvation has a foundation. Let me read with you verses 10, 11, and at least the first part of verse 12 of 1 Peter chapter 1. He says, concerning this salvation, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. It was revealed to them, to those prophets, that they were serving not themselves but you, in the things that have now been announced to you through those who preached the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. These Old Testament prophets, Peter says, searched carefully and inquired, trying to understand the who and the when of their own prophecies. Try to imagine that you're Isaiah. We read this morning from Isaiah 53. Can I encourage you? Hold your place in 1 Peter. I'll do the same. And turn with me to Isaiah, actually the tail end of chapter 52. The end of Isaiah 52. I want you to put yourself for a moment in the sandals of Isaiah and just try to imagine, here you are 750 years before Christ, 750 BC. Imagine that you're given this message. I'm in Isaiah chapter 52, verse 13. Isaiah writes this. This is his message that he proclaimed. Isaiah 52, 13. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard, they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, and we have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation,
Who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. Again, if you put yourself in the shoes and the sandals of Isaiah for just a moment, try to imagine what he's thinking as he gives this prophecy. You and I read Isaiah 52 and Isaiah 53, and we clearly see whom as the servant of the Lord. We do. We see Jesus Christ easily. But Isaiah's writing this, he's proclaiming this 750 years before Christ came to the earth. And you wonder, what's Isaiah thinking? As Isaiah delivers this prophecy, he recognizes it's the word of the Lord. He delivers it to the people, and he says to himself, what is that all about? I wonder what person, I wonder what time, I wonder what the fulfillment of this looks like. And as Peter says, these prophets, these Old Testament prophets, weren't just a little bit curious like George. They diligently searched, they re-examined, they investigated their own prophecies. They looked at other scriptures. They looked at their own times. I'm going to read a little bit of Daniel chapter 9. I don't know if you're still in Isaiah. If you are, you're closer than I am. I flipped back to 1 Peter. Daniel chapter 9. I want to think about this just one more time. How the prophets were, to a great degree, perplexed by the prophecies they gave, wondering, curious about the time and the person, how this is all going to be fulfilled. I'm in Daniel chapter 9. I'll begin at verse 1. Just a handful of verses here. Daniel 9, 1, in the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, by descent a Mede, who was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, perceived in the books the number of years that according to the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet must pass before the end of the desolations of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. So Daniel's reading Jeremiah. Daniel's reading an Old Testament prophet and trying to understand the what, the who, and the when of the fulfillment of Jeremiah's prophecy. And he recognizes that the 70 years that Jeremiah spoke about are about up. Now jump down to verse 20. Daniel says, while I was speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, presenting my plea before the Lord my God for the holy hill of my God, he's praying for Jerusalem. While I was speaking in prayer, the man Gabriel, we'd call him an angel, whom I had seen in the vision at the first, came to me in swift flight at the time of the evening sacrifice. He made me understand, speaking with me and saying, O Daniel, I have now come out to give you insight and understanding. At the beginning of your pleas for mercy, a word went out, and I have come to tell it to you, for you are greatly loved. Therefore, consider the word and understand the vision. And God gives Daniel divine help to understand his question. But all of these Old Testament prophets are living in that context where they understand something of what they say, something of what the other prophets say, but they're perplexed. They're making careful inquiry, trying to understand the fulfillment of their prophecies and the prophecies of their fellow prophets. So Peter and the Old Testament prophets all understood that the Messiah had to suffer before he would be glorified. Peter was initially a bit resistant to a suffering Messiah, wasn't he? You remember when Jesus was teaching his disciples in Mark 8, at least, that he had to suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. After 3 days, rise again. Peter responded to that by taking Jesus aside and rebuking him, saying, no, Lord, that's not going to happen. So Jesus rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You're not setting your mind on the things of God, but the things of man. So Peter, our Peter, had a hard time wrapping his mind around a suffering Messiah. Imagine the Old Testament prophets who made these proclamations on behalf of the Lord, and we're trying to figure out, what is this? What does this look like when it gets fulfilled? So just as Jesus, the Messiah, would experience suffering and then glory in line with these Old Testament prophecies, Peter's readers present suffering. Remember, these readers are scattered. We saw that in verses 1 and 2. Scattered according to the foreknowledge of God, elect strangers. Peter's readers' present suffering would eventually lead to glory. And that's true for us as well. As we anticipate suffering, and we've not known much yet, we might know more in the days ahead. As we anticipate suffering, just understand that present suffering will eventually lead to glory for us as well. Now, in spite of that knowledge that the Old Testament prophets received, they really didn't get much satisfaction. They made careful inquiry. They, for the most part, were perplexed about the meaning of their prophecies and how they applied down the road. They at least learned that the fulfillment of God's messianic prophecies was beyond them. It was beyond their natural context, beyond the course of their own lives. They understood that their prophecies had relevance for their contemporaries, yes, but meaning that went beyond their own times. You remember Paul said to the Romans in Romans chapter 15, whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, right? That through endurance and through the encouragement of the scripture and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. These Old Testament prophecies were bigger than their own context. They've pushed their way on down to encourage us as well. So here's the good news. The good news for Peter's readers, the good news for us, the Old Testament prophecies of a suffering and glorified Messiah have been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. That is good news. Well, it's not just George that was curious. It's not just the prophets that were curious. The angels were curious too. Do you see this at the end of verse 12? These prophets knew that they were writing not just for themselves, but this good news was also carried on to these New Testament believers. The end of verse 12, things, that is this whole message of salvation, things into which angels long to look. Now, the angels are motivated. The angels are motivated to look, to peek, to peep, to peer, as it were. If heaven had an edge, to peer over the edge of heaven, to inspect this business, to try to understand this business of a suffering and glorified Messiah. That must have made no more sense to them than it did to the Old Testament prophets. A suffering and glorified Messiah and the redemption that he accomplished, that would be a mystery to these angels, because angels haven't experienced redemption. God created them. They didn't. The angels who are unfallen didn't fall. They don't know sin. They don't know redemption. And they look over the edge of heaven and say, wow, look what God has done. Last week, what hath God wrought? What has God done accomplishing the redemption of those miserable, rotten sinners down there on earth? Was the suffering of Christ just an unfortunate accident, a tragic mistake? Did the Jews just blow it and somehow they messed up God's plan and that the Christ suffered? That was all just a terrible thing to have happened. No, it was all part of God's plan right from the start. It was not an unfortunate accident. It was not untimely. It was not a tragic mistake. It was a necessity that had been, Peter says, long foretold. The Old Testament prophets made clear proclamation about the suffering and glory of the Messiah. And yet they didn't quite understand what they were proclaiming, and they made careful inquiry trying to figure it out. No, the suffering of Christ and his eventual glorification were not untimely, not an accident, not a mistake. Rather, they were part of God's plan. How about the sufferings of Peter's readers? The suffering of the readers of Peter's letter. These are Christians who are, he tells us in verse 1, elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, areas of Turkey, modern-day Turkey, above the Taurus, north of the Taurus Mountains. Was their suffering a tragic mistake, just an irony of history? Was their suffering just, they just were unlucky? Is that what's going on with them? No, it is not. Their suffering was all part of God's plan as well. So just as the suffering and eventual glorification of the Messiah was foretold, the suffering of Peter's readers was also part of God's plan. They could take great comfort in that. How about us? Are the tough things ahead for us? I don't know what they are. I don't know when they're going to come. But there'll be tough things. Are the tough things that are ahead for us just something that catches God by surprise? He never would have expected it, and we're just going to have to grin and bear it. Is that the case? It is not. The tough things ahead for us are all part of God's plan as well. The divine Lord of the universe, the sovereign one, the one whose providence controls everything for his purposes, he has planned this out. And our suffering also is part of his plan. And that suffering will lead eventually to glory. Suffering's but for a while. Mourning is just for a night. And there'll be a time when joy takes over. Karen Jobes, in her commentary on 1 Peter, says this: the fore witness, that's F-O-R-E, the fore witness of Israel's prophets stood as a confirmation for those who would be called Christians that the executed Jesus was indeed the long-awaited Messiah. It's bigger than that. The fore witness of Israel's prophets let us know that our day's sufferings are indeed just for a bit, and also part of God's plan. Sufferings now, glories to follow. Peter wants to encourage these Christians who face the first to look for the second. For most of us, life is pretty simple and easy, isn't it? Hardly ever do we face static for our Christian faith. Maybe that's because we're quiet about it. Maybe that's because you have a really nice group of friends. But there may come a day, before you know it, when standing for Christ will be costly. And when it is, just know the suffering is but for a bit, and the glory will follow for us as well. We are truly blessed. We live in a time, unlike the Old Testament prophets, we live in a time when we, like Peter's readers, can see the fulfillment of God's promises. And that gives us confidence about the promises that are yet to be fulfilled. How glorious it is to be those who look back at the Old Testament, see it fulfilled in the Gospels, see it fulfilled as the church gets its birth at Pentecost. You and I look back at those events and say, may God be praised. He kept his word. He did what he said he would do. And may that also give us confidence going forward that God will continue to keep his word. It's easy for us to forget what a difficult period it must have been for these Old Testament prophets to make these proclamations that seemed so foreign to them, to think about a suffering Messiah who would eventually be glorified. We have one hymn left to sing this morning. It's Beneath the Cross of Jesus. There's an insert in your bulletin, words on the screen behind me, no doubt. Beneath the cross of Jesus, I find a place to stand. You want to know how to have stability in your life? Turn to Christ. Recognize him for who he is. I wonder at such mercy. You know, the mercy of God. Some of you are reading Dane Ortlund's little book, Something and Lowly. Gentle, thank you. Gentle and lowly. And to just recognize the heart of Christ, I wonder at such mercy that calls me as I am. What should God have done with you? Hands that should discard me hold wounds which tell me, come, beneath the cross of Jesus, my unworthy soul is won. I invite you, if you're able to stand with me, we'll sing these three stanzas together.
Pray for us, Gerald.
May we bow in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your Son who suffered when he began his ministry. He suffered rejection. Lord, even before the cross, he was beaten and wore the crown of thorns and suffered for us. Thank you that he was willing to lay his life down for us, that he loved us with so great a love. Lord, may when the time comes and we have to suffer for him, there is a better day a coming. Lord, we have eternity to spend with our Savior who gave his life for us that we might live. In light of that, Lord, may we live for you. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.